to all frontiers of the possible.
You've chosen to bring to the attention of music listeners three figures who've drawn respect and acclaim for a handful of works, but are little known to the public, especially in America. All three have passed away and are on the verge of being forgotten, except in the memories of hardcore cinephiles. But the eloquence of your music and texts makes clear you think they should be remembered. Please tell us why.
I think the significance of these three artists lies in different areas, which I'll get into. But the common element in their stories is the pathos of untapped potential. First, just let me say that this project is a direct outgrowth of a surge of interest I began experiencing around 20 years ago in the great art films of the 50s, 60s, and 70s. I had seen a decent number of these as a teenager, but revisiting them decades later showed me what I had missed the first time around and spurred me to greatly widen my field of inquiry. My primary focus is the intellectual and emotional content that can be ascribed to individual directors and their collaborating teams. For me, the actors come second, except for those magical moments where their individual brilliance and charisma come to dominate the proceedings in a worthy film. Like many other viewers, I'm pulled more strongly toward the acting of women, who tend to present a wider palette of feelings.
Let's talk about what drew you to the stories of this cycle's protagonists. The first is French actress Anne Wiazemsky.
Well, as some people know, she was the second wife of Jean-Luc Godard, marrying him at 19 in 1967, the high watermark of his worldwide fame and influence. It followed his split with Anna Karenina 2 years earlier. Wiazemsky is known today primarily for her screen debut in Robert Bresson's celebrated 1966 film O Hussard Balthazar, and her depiction of a self-possessed, Mao-obsessed student activist in Godard's La Chinoise. The release of La Chinoise, prefigured by 8 months, the tumultuous events of May 1968, which nearly tore France apart. Wiazemsky had become woke, as they say, during a stretch at the Paris Ex University Nanterre, which dovetailed with Godard's increasing identification with radical politics. Wiazemsky's strong performances in these two films attracted the interest of other directors, most notably the Italian iconoclast Pier Paolo Pasolini, who cast her in two of his greatest and most disturbing creations, Teorema and Porcile. But Wiazemsky's acting career never really picked up further steam after that and eventually petered out.
And why is that?
Well, it's interesting and poignant. Wiazemsky's physical beauty, which prompted the 65-year-old Robert Bresson to sexually harass her during the making of Balthazar, gave the appearance of innocence and fragility. This subjected her to various forms of typecasting, despite the grittiness and political engagement she had shown in La Chinoise. She was never given rein to fully develop her talents. Her husband, a Godard, once referred to her as his animal flower, a phrase that speaks volumes about him, if not her. The couple's collaborations after La Chinoise were modest and small scale, indicating that Godard regarded her as a pliant appendage to his own career, which went flying off the rails after the dystopian film Weekend, in which he famously announced the end of cinema in his final title frame. Godard's emphatic rejection of his own reputation and Wiazemsky's growing disenchantment with his far-left orientation would doom their marriage before long and shrink her professional opportunities. Wiazemsky was highly intelligent and over the course of the 1970s came to fully perceive the shallowness of the film industry and that it ultimately held no desirable place for her as an actress of once great promise.
Thank you.
Your song about her describes a downward psychological slide, a hitting of bottom, and then a long period of reassessment and reinvention. I found your musical depiction of this episode to be quite moving.
Well, thank you very much. Wiazemsky's story, apart from her death at age 70, is not a tragedy, unlike those of my other two subjects. There's plenty of pathos in Wiazemsky's fate as an actress being linked to Godard's own fall from the mountaintop. But in time, through her own hard work, she did reemerge in French cultural life. She found success as a film screenplay writer and director, and as an award-winning novelist. My Berlin Child, an account of her mother's work for the French Red Cross in immediate post-war Berlin, is the only one of her books to be translated into English. I have it right here.
How is it?
I enjoyed it. My parents also lived in immediate post-war Germany, so the book gave me more insight into that grim experience.
Were you aware of the film Godard, Mon Amour, which was released in 2017 but didn't make it to the States until 2018?
No. I didn't hear about it and didn't learn of its existence until sometime in 2020, after I'd finished the Wiazemsky movement. To this day, I haven't seen it, and I don't want to either. I've read that Wiazemsky agreed to the making of the film only on condition that it be designed as a comedy. Strange. But perhaps it's a strong clue as to how she eventually processed her relationship with Godard.